All right, welcome back. Welcome back. And our guest is on set. A man that does not hold back his punches. He calls a spade a spade. He called pumpkin pumpkin. Even though pumpkin don't look like a fruit, a cantaloupe sometimes.
Yes.
Good morning, son.
Good morning to you, and good morning, Tobago, and good morning, Trinidad.
Very good.
Mr. George. I always get my order correct.
Very good. Mr. George, the first time in our history, in our political history, I can't remember, maybe it happened before I was born, that we have gone into an extra day of counting ballots.
Well, I mean, the thing is, I'm trying to think in terms of even our general election, where you have hundreds of thousands of electors, hundreds of thousands of votes and ballots to be counted. And I can't recall a scenario such as this where it has to resume at 2 p.m. the following day, you know. So it's really, I think, a slap in the face of not just the PNM party faithful in Tobago, but I think Tobagonians in general, because at the end of the day, it is a reflection on your leadership. Because if you are in charge of the Tobago Council of the PNM and you can't manage simple internal elections in an efficient and transparent way, then of course it raises questions about your general competence and capability. And I think it's going to really cause lots of conspiracy theories to abound. So, you know, it does not augur well for boosting confidence in the process or in the results, whichever way they ultimately come out.
Very good. All right. So let us, you know, and this is embarrassing. As I said, I was speaking to some friends from Canada there, and they want to know why. My brother in New York, everybody is asking, why is this?
Right. And I mean, in Canada, is millions and millions of votes you're counting.
Exactly.
And they're able to bring in their results.
All right. So what has happened there? All right. Okay. Now, we know that the ballots have been guarded. They resume at 2 o'clock today, as they said. From a legal standpoint, speak to us about any logistics that may be questionable.
Well, the thing is, I guess the first thing you would have to look at is the internal party constitution and what they provide for in such circumstances. So the thing is, that's where you would start if you have to look at any legal implications or ramifications. But I can tell you, I am fairly confident that arising out of this, there would be persons who would be considering their legal options. Because, you see, when you have such a situation, the question is, who is guarding the boxes? Where are they? What is happening to them? You know, so anything that is shrouded in secrecy, or, you know, you don't have the fullest transparency, then that now opens itself to any possible legal challenge. You know, it's almost like they always say, justice must not be a cloistered virtue. In other words, you can't have justice taking place in the dark and in secret. It must be a transparent process. And for Tobagonians to have justice and to have faith in the results of this election, I think there ought to have been some clear, transparent process, just as how we normally expect elections in Trinidad and Tobago to be held, in the full view of the public, cameras there, you have your boards, you count, you put up your scores, you give your results in real time, so therefore people can say, well, yes, we observed what was happening, and therefore we can feel confident with the result that came out.
Wow. All right. Let's examine, and I was doing my own, you know, dissecting and of what was poignant in the in the leading up to the election and statements made by each candidate that I think was significant to speak to. I spoke about Dr. Sayafat saying that no one leader has all the answers. Let's deal with that. I'll give you the four. Right. And she said that very significantly. Mr. Joel Jack said, if we had the waters and the marine boundaries are defined and Tobago knows its place and can get its Tobago internal self-government, we can take care of our own matters here. That's two comments that I think were significant. Kelvin Charles would have historically gotten the Sunwing brand to be part of our tourist arrival, given that, and he has done that. Tracy brings an international, she said, I have international experience, I'm an ambassador, Her Excellency is doing fine in that regard. Now let's put all of these individuals and see how, and this is speaking after the healing, after the this dust has settled, what, from that standpoint, what should be the approach going forward if we are to speak about Tobago's moving forward in terms of its development from these four individuals who has bring different issues to the table that can be treated with in terms of our growth.
Right. Well, I think what is clear is that, you know, unfortunately, what we have witnessed in Tobago over the years is that you have several intelligent, you know, talented, capable, competent people, but everybody's operating in a silo. Each person is functioning in a vacuum mm-hmm. by themselves.
Right.
If we are able to tap into and harness the talents of all the persons who are able to make a meaningful contribution to Tobago, there's no place in the world that could stop us.
Wow.
And we need to understand that.
But contributes to why we operate in silo? Is it an ego thing? It's a me thing?
I think it's a question of power and control. I think it comes down to that, unfortunately. Because the point is, if it is you have to, you know, reach across the aisle and, you know, use the diverse talents, then it means that you are not able to exert that level of control, because then I need you for this idea, I need this one for that idea, I need this person to do that. But if it is that I try to, you know, arrogate all the power onto myself, mm-hmm. then I can now dispense as I choose favors, friends, family, you know, sycophants,
right.
you know, to keep them in line, right. and therefore I retain power. And I think that is what we have witnessed over the years in Tobago, unfortunately, because it not just, you know, what we see within the PNM is a microcosm of what happens generally in Tobago. In other words, even within the party, I mean, a small grouping of people, it appears that they're not able to come together to pull the best and the brightest together to say, well, look, let's all work as a team, as one PNM team for the best of Tobago, for the benefit of Tobago. They're not able to do that. So can you imagine how much more difficult it will be if they have to, say, for instance, draw upon resources from somebody who is capable and talented from the an opposition party, say, for instance, the PDP, or I don't know if they're still at Tobago Forwards, but if they are, you know, you have them, you know. So in other words, if we're not able to straddle that divide and understand that, look, after elections, we have one Tobago. If you understand me, I didn't hear any of the candidates among these four speak of that, you know, like one Tobago. In other words, you have one common vision for Tobago that we all must be on board for, must all embrace. Mm-hmm. That is what is lacking.
My God.
All right.
So let's go to the spillover of the hurt from 2016, because I say spill, you laugh. Because now you know you go through a hurt for a period of time.
Yes.
A girl break your heart, you take a while to get over it. Right? All indicators is that there are people who were toting feelings from since 2016 to now.
Mm-hmm.
Now you spoke of we spoke about the individuals who can contribute.
Mm-hmm.
I am asking. Given, well, we're going to get one winner today, and then the others are going to be losers. That has happened in 2016, and up to now they are healed. Let's talk about what can be done to bring the healing so that we see one Tobago as to translate those individual contributors with their talents and abilities as how we can see Tobago in that scenario.
You see, for that type of scenario, you need a leader who is, first of all, magnanimous.
Okay.
In other words, even in victory, I must be mature, I must be, you know, polite, even to the persons whom I defeated, because I want to draw upon their skills, their talents. I want to be able to utilize whatever they can contribute for the best of Tobago. But you must have someone who is secure within himself or herself, because if it's an person, they wouldn't want strong people around them.
Excellent.
Because they feel threatened by anybody who has, you know, strengths and capabilities that might rival their own.
Okay.
So you have these things that you have to see that you're able to say, well, look, I have a vision whereby I can make use of all
Very
the talent
good.
That is.
We have a technical, we have to go for a break. When we come back, we continue with our conversation. Very interesting, and of course, we are pointing to how we can move on after this election result. See you after the break. All right, welcome back. And of course, our guest, Mr. Martin George, is on set, and we continue our conversation. However, we are joined by Keegan McCool one of our reporters here at Tobago Channel 5, and he has some impertinent information. Good morning, Mr. McCool.
Brother B, good morning to Mr. George, and of course, good morning to Tobago and our viewers on the web who are tuned in. Yeah. So I just came from the Tobago Council's office. As it is, voting is in fact, well, not voting, the counting process is in fact closed off due to, you know, it was a lengthy process. The one man, one vote, it went past what persons expected. If you really think about how they have to do that process, it will take a good bit of time. And what the officers or the machinery of the party decided to do was to put a halt on it, of course, with the consent of the candidates. And they would be resuming the count at 2 p.m. today. So as it is right now, the ballot boxes, because I was there, they asked for the media to supervise the whole process, which I must applaud them for that. As it is, the ballot boxes, the 13 ballot boxes, because there would have been two that officially declared, which is John Dial, and let me just check. That would be John Dial and Palatavir, right? Those two would be declared. We're still waiting on 11 more, and as it is, they are being guarded by the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service, along with the political officers at the party. Eventually, when the count resumes, the presiding officers or the deputy presiding officers from the respective polling stations will be called back in to resume the count under the supervision of the political officers and under the protection of the police service. And the agents for each candidate will be allowed on the premises, not inside where the ballot boxes are, to avoid tampering, but they will be around in close vicinity outside the headquarters of the Tobago Council of the PNM. Mm-hmm.
All right, and could you just tell us about the voter turnout? Was it low, was it high in terms of numbers? How many people registered to vote?
All right, well, in terms of the voter turnout, I can't actually give you those figures right now, but for what was projected by the chairman, Mr. Alvin Pascal of the Elections Committee, is that they predict a somewhat 50%, somewhere around 50% voter turnout. As I said, we only have two official polling stations declared. Looking at the numbers, we have in total, if you look at all 13 polling stations, there would be somewhere close to about 10,000 members that would be eligible to vote. Now, this is just the numbers of persons eligible to vote. The voting in itself would not reflect that. All right, there would have been some persons that there was the discrepancies of the rejected ballot and the spoiled ballot. Now, let me take some time to just explain that. The rejected ballot would be ballots that would be placed in the box, but there are 17, you have 17 pages on the booklet to vote 17 times with different people for different positions. You have the choice. You can vote for two positions, you can vote for one, you could vote for however many. But the remaining ballots that probably were unmarked, they will stay inside there, but they will be rejected ballots. Again, if you did not vote for certain candidates in certain positions, those will be rejected ballots within the box. Added to that, you would have, if you have markings that are not so clear in between the two candidates, those will also be rejected ballots within the box, as long as they can't make the final decision there. Then there are spoiled ballots. Well, persons who definitely would have made mistakes and have to go back, they were definitely spoiled ballots and they would not have been submitted into the box. So as it is, you'd be hearing figures that you'd be getting somewhat like 250-something rejected ballots within one polling station, or 100-something ballots with rejected ballots within that polling station. These are not necessarily persons or electorate persons who are being rejected. These are just within this, across the 17 positions. So you may have somebody who would actually vote for two positions, and then the other 15 positions, those will be the rejected ballots. So they all being tallied will give you that accumulated figure.
Okay.
Well, the thing is, Mr. McCool, the difficulty I have with that explanation, and if that's the explanation coming officially from the party, is that why is a ballot paper which has no marking on it considered a rejected ballot? In other words, there's nothing for me to count there. So to even describe it as a rejected ballot, in other words, if you have chosen 2 out of the 17, as you have indicated, then I'm not sure that I follow the logic of saying that the others that are unmarked are rejected ballots. There's nothing to count then, so there's nothing to reject in that sense. So, you know, the thing is, I think even that type of terminology, because I follow what you're saying in that when the numbers come out, if people hear large numbers of rejected ballots, then again, people tend to think, well, why was my ballot rejected, or why were so many ballots rejected? So I think that definitely they need to fine-tune the language and the way they communicate this.
Okay.
So as to lessen the, you know, the capacity for suspicion that, look, something has gone wrong. Okay. Because it doesn't seem to me that a ballot on which no marking is made at all ought to be properly classified or categorized as rejected.
Let me interject there. Now, firstly, let me clarify. I am not the Tobago Council of the PNM. I am only covering elections, and I'm doing it extensively, and I'm based on, and I'm trying my best to give you that explanation, and they would have done so, especially Mr. Pascal. They've been very cordial with us. The thing about the rejected ballots with the no markings, you have to remember it's a booklet of 17. So you have 17 positions and it's a booklet of 17. So what would happen is that they would cast their votes on each 17 pages. If you don't cast your vote on the 17 pages, then let's say, for instance, you vote for 5 positions, then your booklet is submitted. All right? Your booklet is submitted into the ballot. So the other
16.
Well, no, if it's 5 positions, it will be 12.
Right.
So the other 12 positions will be vacant and they will be rejected ballots because they are in the box. And those before, or the 5 that were there, those are actually eligible votes that will be counted. And the others, well, if you choose, that's your choice. That's the whole aim of the one man, one vote. That's what they explain. That's their choice. If they want to vote for this one or that one, or they don't want to vote for these positions, that's the choice of the membership. And as it is, in some cases, those will be rejected. And there would be high volumes of persons having rejected ballots because not much persons were familiar with the process. I think that the party needs to do more education with regards to its members where that is concerned. And generally, political parties in general need to do education with the whole voting process of the electorate.
So you would say, is this one man, one vote, this new concept is what caused this confusion, more or less? Because as you explained there, if I, let's say that I am choosing one of the candidate out of the 16, and I chose one, the rest of those on the slate is rejected, that's what you're saying.
Could you repeat that?
Let's say I choose one. Let's say the political leader is who I'm voting for. Let's say I'm choosing that one individual.
Okay.
Her or his slate is comprised of 15 more people.
Yeah.
And I did not choose any of those. I just voted for the one leader.
Yeah, right.
The rest of those ballots or the rest of those
on that booklet will be rejected votes.
Right, but
while the vote for the political leader will be considered and counted.
But just clarify something, because I'm not sure that I understood accurately what Brother B was saying, because I don't think, I mean, of course, I have absolutely no knowledge as to how PNM internal elections work, but
good.
I'm just thinking from a common sense perspective.
Right.
It doesn't seem as if there would be slates listed on the ballot. I don't think that's how it.
Yes,
they
how it is. It's, remember, it's one man, one vote. So even though you have a slate, you still have to go through the one man, one vote.
Right.
So you're voting for each position. So where in the past you would have voted for the political leader and chairman, and you get their slate.
Exactly. Right.
You have to vote everybody into that position.
And that's the point I'm making. So there wouldn't be a slate on the ballot paper.
And let me clarify that again. There is, in fact, there would have been candidates who would have had their slates, and if that would be the persons who would have the larger slates would have been the incumbent, Mr. Kelvin Charles, and
Ms. Davidson
would have a slate. The other candidates, of course, they would have been up in the political leader position.
Know,
they would have some in their slate, and then they would have other people independent.
Request, yeah. Listen to what I'm asking you. On the voting booklet, you would have seen
there's in terms of like what there would be is there's the symbol for the slate for each candidate on that. So if you want, you don't even need to look at the person's name. You could just vote the symbol.
Right. But in other words, it's listed in positions. In other words,
yes.
Political leader, deputy.
Yes.
Right. So it's not that you have a slate one slate.
On one page.
On one page. That's right. The point I'm making. Right.
17 pages. Right.
You have to go through the 17 pages.
That's right.
All right. Yeah. So, all right, just give us a recap as to what has happened, transpired, and where we are presently.
All right. So, as it is, the voting process has been halted until 2 p.m. this afternoon. The ballots themselves are currently being guarded by the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service under the supervision of the Tobago Council PNM election officers. Later on at 2 p.m. today, the presiding officers and deputy presiding officers from the respective polling stations will be called back in to resume the count under the supervision of the political officials within the head office and under the protection of the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service. Added to that, the agents for each candidate within this internal election will also be allowed within the vicinity of the headquarters, but not inside when the boxes are being counted. And this is to prevent the occurrence or any possible occurrence of tampering with the ballots themselves.
All right, one last question, Mr. McCool. I'm just thinking, mm-hmm. in terms of the 13 boxes which are under guard, mm-hmm. some of those ballots from those boxes would have been counted.
From two boxes only.
All right, so out of the 13, mm-hmm. any of the ballots from any of those 13 were counted?
All right, out of the 13 polling stations, two official polling stations were declared. Two, and that is John Dial and Palatavia. Those votes and ballots were counted outright. With the other ballots and boxes, they would have counted, they would have stopped now. And it's a process where they would have stopped probably at the last three positions, where they still have to count the positions, because what they're doing is that they're counting the entire 17 positions before declaring the figures.
Right, I know, but just listen mm-hmm. to me, mm-hmm. because I got the impression from what you told us previously that there were 15 polling divisions. And of the 15, two
13,
were
13, oh, sorry, 13 polling
total.
Divisions,
13.
And two were declared.
All right, so therefore there are 11 boxes.
So there are 11 right. still incomplete that will be counted from 2 p.m.
Right, and my question is, from those 11, mm. some votes have been counted.
Yes, some will actually be, and it's dependent on the size of or the volume of members that would have been right. designated to that polling
station. I follow
you.
My question is, the ballots that have already been counted, where are they and who is guarding those?
And this is what I'm saying. The ballots that have already been counted, from my understanding, because the boxes are locked and sealed, the ballots that have already been counted, they have all been separated into various envelopes, not sealed, but separated into various envelopes. This was under the supervision of all the candidates, of course, and their agents. They would have been separated there and they would resume their counting process just as when they were doing it then, they stopped at that point. They put it within the envelope so they could just pull it back out and resume. Nothing was mixed. What was counted already was already put aside. How they did the counting process is that they would have counted from the chairman go up. So it's the chairman. They would have counted out that position. Then the political leader count out that position. Then the vice chairman, lady vice chairman, and they go down the line like that. And they're doing it that way. As from what they explained to us, they're doing it that way. So they can probably get in front of a ballot, probably getting loose into a different position by mistake or whatever. So they're making sure that they're doing thorough checks. So they'll be checking it like two or three times, depending on things
go. All right. So let me just be clear. To understand what you're saying, that the ballots that have already been counted mm-hmm. are in envelopes and those are back in the ballot boxes.
Well,
because
yes.
that's what I'm asking
yes.
you.
They
are
all sealed. All the ballot boxes have been sealed and locked. And they can only be reopened by the presiding or deputy presiding officers that were at the respective stations.
I hear you, Mr. McCool, but mm-hmm. I need to be clear on what I'm asking
sure.
you. I'm asking you, from the 11 boxes, mm-hmm. the votes that have been counted already,
they are all sealed in the box. Those that are counted, put in envelopes,
put
and those that are uncounted, yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But they have been separated in such regards that they are separated into positions. So the positions would be, the votes would be separated into political leader all the way down to treasurer into envelopes. So what they have at this point is that they would have already separated the positions. So in the ballot boxes, what they will do now is that they will continue resuming counting the actual votes for the positions.
Okay.
In some cases, they would have probably declared 16 of the 17 positions. In other cases, they would have declared 9 of the 17 positions, but they are all locked away in the ballot boxes, the respective ballot boxes, in the various executive positions.
Very good. All right, Mr. Makul, we want to thank you very much. And of course, well, you gave us an entire expedition there. And of course, Mr. George wanted to be clear. So at this point in time, we go for a break. When we come back, we have lots more for you. See you then. All right, welcome back. Welcome back. And of course, we want to thank Mr. Keegan McCool for all that information. All right, Mr. George, we were in the middle of, and you said first time, long time you're drinking in our milk cup, right?
Well, the thing is, and this is compliments, Nana. Yeah. You all will remember when I was in Japan and I sent a little video showing a place saying Nana Coffee. And I said, Nana have a business in Japan. But anyway, Nana making coffee.
That's right, great. All right, so let's continue. I could tell, well, you have a passion for Tobago's development. There's nothing else you would like to see, or any conscious Tobagonian would love to see Tobago reaches to a certain place. All right. So we have identified that there are individuals in the PNM that has ideas or have ideas that can transform into actuality, that we can be better off as a people. Mm-hmm. There are issues that we're still running to Trinidad for, Mr. George. You would know from a legal standpoint, matters with land issues, tongue and country, and all of that. How do we sit down and get to the place where we can rely on the skill sets to bring to bear on what is needed in Tobago, that needs to be in Tobago, that we don't have to leave Tobago for? How do we come to that?
The most fundamental change that we would need to look at in that regard would be the question of the Tobago House of Assembly Act. And I'll tell you why. For years, we as Tobagonians, we've been beating our chests and feeling proud that, you know, we have this great vehicle or mechanism called the Tobago House of Assembly. But in reality, we are little more than a glorified version of a regional corporation. If you look at the Regional Corporations Act, mm-hmm. and you'll see how those corporations are set up and structured, we are just a glorified version of that. So when we talk about ideas of self-governance, etc., we really are just fooling ourselves, because we want to, as you would have said, you know, in years ago, you know, you say, play manish.
Right.
You want to feel your big, you know. But in reality, we don't control the means, we don't control our income, we don't control anything of the sort. All we do basically is go every year, cap in hand, asking for basically the subvention from central government, and then of course we spend it on things, and there's a question of, you know, how you account for that, and, you know, your role in terms of your fiscal responsibility. But what we need to do is look at that act, because it has not given us what we thought it would have done.
Does that?
No, I just want to make the point. Mm-hmm. The judgment a couple of years ago by the Honorable Justice Kangaloo is a judgment I would encourage all Tobagonians to read. Look at that judgment, look at what it says, because essentially what the judge ruled is that once central government sets a policy, the THA has no power whatsoever to override or even deviate from that policy. So in other words, even though, right, I have you running free, you're on a leash. I might let out some string so that, you know, you get a little freedom, but you're still on a leash. The minute I pull back that leash, you come back to me, because I have the control. And that's the essential role as to the central government vis-a-vis the Tobago House of Assembly.
Let's go to the internal self-government bill, that we release that shackle once and for all. Why is that not taken priority? Is it, and Mr. Hochaicha said, we here in Tobago are responsible for that, because we are not, well, he didn't say advocating, he's suggesting the minds like yours and others who recognize that we're on a shackle, we're on a leash, needs to speak to Trinidad with one voice about giving us our freedom. Mr. Joel Jack pointed to should we get our freedom and demarcating our boundaries, our maritime boundaries, that with our gas and our resources out there, natural gas and oil and so on, we can be better off as a people by dictating our own peace in terms of how we manage our resources, our finances, and all of that. Speak to that. This one voice concept that is needed, that is not happening because people like yourself will not speak to the issue, or will with the one voice concept. Talk to us about that.
All right. The thing is, just by way of clarification, I think Mr. Jack respectfully has conflated two ideas there which are not necessarily in congruence. Because if you think of it, the idea of your own self-government, self-governance or self-determination has nothing to do with the question of nationhood status.
Good.
And I'll tell you why that's important. Because once you start talking about maritime boundaries, there cannot be maritime boundaries within a country,
a
unitary state.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, that again is an artificial construct.
Hmm.
So of course, Tobagonians are always proud and, you know, we feel good to hear that, well, within our waters, there's oil and gas. No, sorry. Get over it.
Wow.
It's with the waters of Trinidad and Tobago.
Uh-huh.
All right? So in other words, what you may have to look at is, okay, what is my representative share of these common resources?
All right. Good.
That's a different thing. But when you start talking about maritime boundaries, then that's a totally different thing. If you are a separate nation state, then, of course, you have maritime boundaries, you have territorial waters. So I think Tobagonians need to, you know, debunk these ideas and get these ideas out of their heads that, you know, Tobago has its own maritime boundaries. We do not. It's the state of Trinidad and Tobago that has maritime boundaries, and within those maritime boundaries, we have common and shared resources.
Mm-hmm.
As to how those resources are allocated and distributed is a different thing.
Right. Well, let's talk now. So let's talk, Mr. Jeff. Listen, at the end of this result, what Tobago should be speaking to is how we get our, I'm going to use your term, our share of the natural resources, which Tobago, in my view, and all of us would recognize every year, when they allocate the amount, it could barely buy bread in the supermarket. It barely goes around the recurrent expenditure. There's hardly anything for development, and we continue to cry until the next year. How do we get the national conversation to be that we are deserving of an equal share of the pie? How do we speak that, given that we don't want to talk separation, because when we talk, that is what you mentioned that without saying it. But let's go there. How do we get the equal share of the pie, as it were?
All right. Well, first of all, I would hope that what you really mean is an equitable share.
Equitable share.
As opposed to equal share.
Well,
because if you say equal, you're talking 50-50, which is an impractical construct.
All right, wait. Let me just use a local explanation or an analogy. Right, if I'm planting peas, We are neighbors, right?
Right.
And I have the peas planted by me.
Yes.
The both of us plant the peas. So this is our peas. But this peas is over by me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have the clout of owning the peas, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It is in my boundary. This belongs to me.
Mm-hmm.
However, we have a relation. We plant the peas together. We have these two boundaries was just really, really recently separated and so on by demarcations and so on. But when it comes to sharing the peas, I should say, or you should say, hello, we plant this peas together. And I want my equal share. There's where I want to go because peas really belongs to me.
Okay, all right. And the thing is, when you look at it, the equality would then now be based upon numbers.
Good.
And sizes.
All right.
Okay? So therefore, you compare landmass size of Tobago as compared to Trinidad. You compare population size of Tobago as compared to Trinidad. And that's the only way you can have, and as I say, what you'll end up with is equity, not equality.
Right.
Because in other words, if you were to take 50% of the national budget every year to give to Tobago to say, well, it's one island and one island, so you all take 50-50, then obviously that could not be a practical suggestion by anyone with half a brain, if you understand me. So therefore, we have to look at equity, whereby you say, look, all right, in terms of what your needs are for your population, we look at that, Then what we have to factor in, and this is where I think we can make a sensible, logical, legal argument, is the disadvantageous position that Tobago and Tobagonians find themselves in terms of access to resources.
Okay.
You're talking about educational resources, health facilities, you know, you name it. All the resources that we need which are not available in Tobago, then I think you can make a very good argument to raise the share that Tobago gets, because you will say, look, Tobagonians are disadvantaged. Because you remember, and the last time I was on the set, the example I gave. If at all you have persons from South Trinidad who are cut off, in other words, that highway is impassable. There's no way for them to get to North Trinidad to conduct their business. You would see them burning tires in the streets every morning. And it would be the biggest news because of the fact that they can't get access. And I say this is exactly what Tobagonians are subjected to when, for instance, we've had scenarios where the ferry has broken down, there's no boat going, you can't get a flight to go down because all the flights are booked. That is exactly the type of scenario. So therefore, that's the disadvantage factor which we must now add on. In other words, because no Trinidadian has to pay an airfare of $300 to get anywhere in Trinidad, if you understand. And that's where you talk about the disadvantage factor. No Trinidadian has to pay an airfare to take their child down to Mount Hope Hospital. If you understand, these are the things that we must now factor in. But then, of course, the corollary to that is that we must ensure that when we have the budgetary allocation, that we give good accounting for what we do with it. We show value for money, and we are able to show Tobagonians, hey, listen, this is where your money was invested. This is where your money was invested. This is what we did with it. This is the balance, or this is the surplus. You know, this is what we project for next year. That we have not seen, because all we have seen really is just a merry-go-round. In other words, money comes in at one end, it spits out, and then at the end you come back and you beg for more and you go for the next year again. Because as you yourself said, most of it goes on recurrent expenditure, salaries, wages, bills, expenses. The thing is, that's not sustainable. In other words, if all I'm doing is earning to spend without any investment, then I will never
Stay there, Mr. Martin George. Now, for, you know, this, if you have a piggy bank, and there's nothing coming in, and there's only coming out, and one day it's going to finish, right? Let's talk about Tobago investments. You, as an attorney, would deal with a number of matters dealing with land. This land license issue. For our development, you have traveled all over the world. You've seen development. You've seen investors. You go right there in St. Martin, the Hard Rock Cafe is there. Right, you know that's a foreign investor St. Martin. Let's talk about those types of investment that is critical to developing any country in the world, international or foreign investment.
Well, I would say that foreign license regime has been one of the most devastating things ever to Tobago and its investments. We've had clients who were out of the United Kingdom who had a massive project planned for up Corland and up in the east by Englishman's Bay. That entire thing was scrapped. They were not able to get past the land license issue.
What is, give me some legal, speak to us as to what curtails the, from one stage to the next. Why is it taking so long? Why people are frustrated and leaving this island when they have to treat with this land license?
Well, the thing is, it's similar to what has happened with the procurement legislation. First of all, they took years to actually put the mechanisms into effect to allow you to actually be able to access it, okay? Because the point is, when you proclaim legislation, then you have regulations which will now govern the implementation and the mechanisms to actually work the, if you proclaim the legislation without the regulations, then nobody can use it. So in other words, you will say, yes, it's there on paper, but the point is, it cannot be used. So that happened with the land license. For years, the regulations were not put in place. Then when they were put in place, it appeared that between the Ministry of Finance and the Tobago House of Assembly, either there was not enough communication, or whatever communication there was, it was discordant. So it ended up being a cacophony of sound, just, you know, like a babble of noise. Mm-hmm. So therefore, you go to the THA, they're telling you, well, no, 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 you have to go to the Ministry of Finance for that. When you go to the Ministry of Finance, they're sending you back to the THA. And the thing is, for foreigners who come for business purposes,
they don't have that time.
Not just that. Mm-hmm. It's not just the time. It's the patience and the frustration. And you feel as if the idea these people are telling me is they don't really want my money. Mm-hmm. They don't really want me to invest.
Right.
So in other words, let me go Grenada, let me go St. Lucia, let me go St. Martin, let me go Barbados, where they roll out a red carpet for me as an investor. You know, they treat me to the finest. They allow me to be able to facilitate my business in speedy time. They give me everything to assist my investment. They ensure that they get, you know, what is due to the government out of it. But the point is, we work together to ensure that the project goes ahead. That's how you do business. You don't do business by trying to frustrate every potential investor to the point where people, the word out on the international capital markets is, do not go to Tobago.
Wow.
Because of the difficulties that this legislation has presented. We of the business chamber, we have called upon the government repeatedly to just simply repeal that legislation. Mm-hmm. Because the part of the thinking behind it when it was brought into effect was that, you know, it will stop Tobagonians from selling out their land.
I think that was the idea.
Right? And I spoke to the then chief secretary, Mr. Orville London, and I told him, I said, chief, that will never work, because what you will end up doing is you will just shift it from being foreigners buying the lands to rich Trinidadians coming and buying the lands. And that's exactly what has happened.
My God.
There are so many parcels of land in Tobago that Trinidadians have quietly come across, they've purchased. Most times they didn't do anything with it, they just have it there. When the time is right, they will. So in other words, you've not stopped Tobagonians from selling their lands.
Right.
All you've done is shift who the owners are.
Good.
And the point is, if you're talking about a foreign exchange crisis or a foreign exchange shortage, then it would seem to me that it's more attractive to get the foreign investment in, right? You therefore now boost up your foreign exchange reserves. You also allow new ideas, new projects to come. Some people may build small hotels, they may build big developments, but the idea is that you want to encourage investment, and you must have that investor-friendly climate approach.
Right.
It cannot be that you appear antagonistic, or belligerent to investors, and then you say, well, I'm not getting foreign investment. Duh.
Okay. It's going to get it. All right, let's deal with after this internal results today, when we get in. What if you had to speak to the leader, whoever emerges as leader today? There's so many things that needs to be done in Tobago. But if you had to speak to the leader to address any one issue that you think needs or is priority, should be priority number one, what would you suggest to that leader?
I would suggest that you, first of all, be mature, be magnanimous, and be all-encompassing. In other words, we have, I'll tell you, brilliant, talented Tobagonians all over the world. You and I have friends in Switzerland, from Tobago.
That's right.
You know, we have persons all over the world who can contribute. Listen, there are many people who are willing to contribute. We had a scenario some years ago where there was this woman who acted as a senior nurse in hospitals abroad, and she wanted to come back to Tobago.
Yeah.
And just to give her service as a nurse, the amount of hurdles obstacles they put in her way, she got frustrated and she said, look, I will retire in Barbados instead, where they were willing to accept her. If you understand me.
Yes,
so
yes,
you
yes.
talk, and listen, her service was voluntary, she was given,
Wow.
And still we put in obstacles for a Tobagonian to come back and give that service.
Yeah.
You know? So the thing is, we need to tap into the diaspora. The first thing I would encourage is that, look, we start creating that network, right? If you notice, there are quite a few African countries that are doing that.
Mm.
Ghana recently had a very big welcome home ceremony for all Ghanaians. Right? They said, listen, come back,
and
contribute.
Give back,
and if you look at what is happening economically, Ghana is a country on the rise. They are on the upswing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Our current Minister of Public Utilities, he served in Ghana.
Yes.
And we have quite a few Trinbagonians who are in Ghana right now. So the thing is, We need to tap into that, you know, resource out there. You have lots of Tobagonians who are willing to invest monies in Tobago, but they need to understand that, look, you have a climate that is facilitative of this and whereby their investments can bring contributions and bring rewards. Mm-hmm. It must not be in a situation where they feel, well, look, I would get in, you know, to some difficulty or problems, right. you know, otherwise, I will go somewhere
exactly.
else. You will go where it is easier to make your investment.
Right.
So the thing is, like, we need to understand the strength of who we are and what we have. That's the first thing.
Right.
And then you now need to rise above the political pettiness and the victimization and back. In other words, okay, on the hustings of the election, of course, yes, right, you will get into your, you'll trade your barbs.
Mm.
But once the election is over, show that you are the bigger man. Show that you are willing to reach across the aisle, reach across to even the defeated candidates and say, hey, listen, all right, election is over. You have this particular skill. You have international experience. You have experience in finance. You have experience in this. You know, I need you all in these positions because we want to now work together. And you manage it that way. The thing is, listen, let me tell you, the most successful people in the world is not because they know everything or they can do everything, but they know how to hire and utilize the talent of people who are capable and good at what they do.
Right.
So in other words, Bill Gates doesn't know everything about, you know,
but
computers. But that's right.
Yeah, right.
So the engineers he will hire in their specific areas, they are way ahead of him in terms of their knowledge set. But they're working for him to produce a product that is universally accepted. And as I say universal, I'll just share with you this anecdote from Mr. Arthur Lockjack. You know, chatting with him some time ago, you know, he explained to me, he said, Martin, you know, many of the companies I own, I know nothing about running them.
Very good.
He said, but I hire people
wow.
who know what they're doing.
Exactly.
And they make money for me. That's what a good leader does.
Wow.
So in other words, you recognize that, look, there are limitations. You can't know everything about
exactly.
everything
yeah.
and be good at everything. But the thing is, you see, we like to create these tin gods, you know, whereby, you know, we feel, well, look, if I give this person that authority, then they may get powerful and I may lose status. So therefore, I must keep them down and fight them down and make sure. So in other words, you have so many good ideas, good talents that have been offered to Tobago, but they've been shot down because of the insecurities of the persons who are in charge.
So you're expecting magnanimity.
Magnanimity.
Yes, that's a step of the tongue. But anyway, and closing, Mr. George, and we want to thank you very much. And we hope that they've listened to you. And we expect that after this election, we can see Tobago going forward with all the ideas on the table. Closing, what would you like to say? Quickly?
Well, in closing, I would like to tell Tobagonians in general, don't ever despair in terms of your ability. In other words, you would like to harness and maximize your ability and your potential within this space that we all love called Tobago. If it is that you are not getting that opportunity, develop it elsewhere, and then maybe at a later time you may be able to return and contribute something to Tobago. But know that the power and the strength lies within you, within each and every one of us. And we together, collectively, regardless of your political persuasion or, you know, who you support, once we have that love for Tobago, I tell you, Tobago can be the greatest little island on the face of this earth.
Well, we're calling on you, you know. We want to see that you are the bigger man. I'm not going to repeat that word, and I want to thank you, sir. And we always look forward to having conversations with you about Tobago's, because I know you have a passion for this.
Yeah,
place.
It's always a pleasure.
Of course.
And
right.
You see, I always say, you know, I'm going to be, it's by us having this type of elevated discourse. You know, I mean, of course, nobody could lime and talk foolishness in a rum shop or wherever like me. But at the end of the day, there's a time and place for everything.
Exactly.
And this type of, you know, discourse is important to open people's minds so that they think differently, they see things differently, they assess, they analyze. They don't have to accept what I say or what you say, but at least we throw out an idea that makes them look at something differently and say, hey, maybe there's a different
way.
All right. And that's all.
All right. And of course, Grover and Prisoner is here.
Yes. Say hello to them.
Yeah. And of course, you know, I want to run up there and see how they're behaving up there. And say, All right. So when we come back, I thank Mr. George again. And of course, very energetic. And, you know, he doesn't hold back his punches. All right. And at the end of the day, it's for Tobago's development, as he said. All right. When we come back, the Tobago Drama Guild, will be on set. And we'll have that conversation. Writers Guild, not drama. Oh, my goodness. Writers Guild, Mr. Pigotundi. All right. So he's drama and he's a writer. See you after the break. Best.